Pastor Valerie Holcomb would like to welcome all of our first-time visitors, returning visitors, and CHOP family and friends to the Christian House of Prayer Ministries. Thank you for joining us for our 10 a.m. service. We pray that you'll experience the light, life, and love of God during this morning service. Again, we say welcome and look forward to seeing you again next week right here at the Christian House of Prayer Ministries, where it's all about Him, Jesus Christ.
Today, put those hands together. He said, I want to be. let's just begin to lift our hands this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we come this morning yielding our will for your will. We come worshiping you in spirit and in truth. And we're asking that you just take your place in our lives, because all honor and all glory, it belongs to you.
Glory. Just lift your hands and say glory.
Just lift your hands toward heaven and declare that he is holy, the Holy One. He's the sovereign one. He's the almighty one. We give glory. Yeah. Great and marvelous are your deeds. Just and true are your words. God Almighty, we give glory. For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship you, Lord. We sing glory.
Please join me at this time as we declare the 91st Psalm. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wing shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him, and show him my salvation. A message from our pastor. Thank you, Christian House of Prayer family and friends, for your prayers, condolences, cards, flowers, gifts of love, and monetary gifts during the passing of our beloved mother, Joan West. We will never forget your love and support. You all have been such a blessing. Love, Pastor Valerie Hocum. Perfect Praise Learning Center would like to say thank you to the Christian House of Prayer for your generous donation. During this year's Perfect Praise Learning Center's coat drive, we were able to donate over 100 new coats. Special thanks to Tasha Young and Denise Chisholms for distributing coats. The Prison and Jail Ministry's Angel Tree signups will resume next Sunday, December the 6th, which will be the last day for signups. All gifts must be turned in no later than December 13th to be delivered on the 20th. Stop by the counter in the foyer next Sunday for more information. The Christian House of Prayer has made giving easy, safe, and convenient. Log on to CHOP.org or the CHOP app to give from your electronic devices. Give by mail at P.O. Box 960, Coppers Cove, Texas 76522. As we self-quarantine this Sunday, you may give in person at the Covenant Savings Federal Credit Union 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. God has been a faithful God and always will be. So let's continue to do the practical and watch Him do the providential in this season. Covenant Savings Federal Credit Union has you covered when you're in the market for a new or used car. Introducing one of our newest products from the IWS Acquisition Corporation. Designed to protect our customers from the high cost associated with owning a new or used vehicle. With every new or used car purchase, we're offering an extended warranty program, protecting you from the high cost of unexpected mechanical repairs. We're also offering gap insurance for that extra protection in the event of a collision, along with RestoreGuard, which helps to keep your vehicle looking newer longer. Purchase your new or used vehicle with peace of mind, knowing that Covenant Savings has you covered with a variety of products to keep costs down when it comes to owning a new or used vehicle. These products are available to members and non-members alike. For more information, call us at 254-634-8014. People are standing in line to get into this church to hear the Word of God. Every seat is filled in every service with expectations of signs, wonders, and miracles. Our Sunday morning service at 10 o'clock in Killeen, our Wednesday night service at 7 o'clock in Killeen, and any other service that we might have. Every need in this ministry is met, and we are 100% tithe givers. All of our property is paid off in full, and we owe nothing to no man but to love. Every member of this church is healed, healthy, blessed, and prosperous, and we are reaching the world with the gospel through our prayers and support. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been open. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been open. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. For this is a prosperous year for us, and the door of success has been opened. We shall succeed in everything in Christ. The doors of failure have been closed, and we shall not know defeat. And being fully persuaded that what He hath promised, He was able also to perform. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Our pastor, Valerie Holcomb, has taught us that we move from faith to faith and then into confidence with God. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Let's enjoy this message from our beloved Bishop Nate Holcomb entitled, Faith's Progression into Confidence. Keep your hope up.
Last week we came out of Romans chapter 4 and we talked about, hallelujah, Jesus. He's the promise keeper. And this week we are going to come from chapter 5. He made a promise to Abraham and Sarah, and Abraham and Sarah became the father and mother of the faithful. And he's not saying that Abraham was father God, but he was the father of the faithful. He stayed with God, and he was 99 years old when God said, now is the time to have Isaac. Prior to that time, Sarah came with her own idea and said, let's go ahead and have my friend Hagar as a surrogate mother to have her for me, since I cannot have. And God is giving you a promise, and he does not want you to perform it. He will perform the promise. And the scripture says in Romans 4:21, and Abraham being fully persuaded, now he had to get fully persuaded, being fully persuaded that what God had promised, God was able to perform. All God asks you to do is to be obedient to his word. Now from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5, we will read. Therefore, as a result of what I just gave you from chapter 4, Abraham and Sarah, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access. I love that. The door is open. Access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations, also knowing that tribulations worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. Say hope three times. And verse 5, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his word. And all God's people said amen and amen. Amen. Give three people a high five and tell them it's all about him. Go ahead. It's all about him. It's all about him. Jesus Christ. It's all about him. And today we want to talk about faith's progression into confidence. Faith progression into confidence. Faith's progression into confidence. In other words, keep your hopes up. Keep your hopes up. And the reason why hope is so important, it's a confident, favorable expectation. Because in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, it says, now faith is the substance of things that we hope for. So if we lose our hope, then your faith has nothing to give substance to. Because faith is the substance of things that we hope for. In verse 6, it says, but without faith, it is impossible to please God. What pleases God is faith. And what faith is, it's saying, I believe in God. I believe in what God says to me will come to pass. And that's the reason why we come to church, so we can hear the word of God. And if we hear the word of God, then we will have faith. And if we have faith, don't lose your hope. Don't lose your hope. Notice now, I want you to see how important and how emphatic this is. So many people fall aside and on the side of the highway of heaven, meaning they're going to heaven, but they have broken down and they're not moving forward. Faith is forward action in trusting him. F-A-I-T-H, forward action in trusting him. Faith is always on the move forward, action in trusting him. But some people are broken down on the highway of heaven because they don't understand faith's progression into confidence. Hope is a confident, favorable expectation. Say that. Hope is a confident, favorable expectation. And see, hope, listen now, hope, it lives off the promises of God. Remember last week we gave you that Greek word for the word promise. Do anyone remember that? Epangela. Epangela. E-P-A-N-G-E-L-L-A. Thank you, Elder Gary. Epangela. And what it means is a commitment to do something in the future. It's a commitment. A promise is a commitment to do something that you're going to do in the future. And God through his son, Jesus Christ, what we just read. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God. Why? Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Jesus is that promise keeper. And as we pursue Jesus, as we follow the good shepherd, great shepherd, chief shepherd, he's going to lead us through the path and through the valley. He's going to lead us if we would just follow Jesus. And when we talk about this progression, notice where it starts. He says in verse 2, but whom, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace. Grace is God's unmerited favor. Grace is what God gives unto us gratis that we don't deserve. Grace, as it were, is what God gives to us. We don't earn anything, but what he wants us to do is to learn about the one who can do everything. And that's Jesus Christ. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? No. So you don't earn nothing with God. You learn. Hello. You learn. And this is what he says. He says, and we rejoice in hope. Notice that. Rejoice in hope of the glory of God. The glory of God. God's not through with you. Look at your neighbor and say, he's not finished yet. Now, let me take that back, because God has finished the work, but he got to walk you through the work. He's already finished the work. Praise the Lord. He's Alpha and Omega. He's the first and the last. And in other words, the reason why you're going to win at the end is because it's already written in the script. Hallelujah. It's already written in the script. That's how you know you're going to win at the end. It's written in the script. It's already written. And this is what he says. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope, and hope maketh not ashamed. Now, when we see this, the first thing in terms of the progression of faith, the first thing is the word has to come. See, you cannot have faith if you don't have the word. The word. Now, I'm giving you six steps. If you would please say that, six steps. When Solomon built the temple of the Lord, Solomon built the temple. David was in the tabernacle, but when Solomon built the temple, meaning that it would not be moved, he built the temple with six steps that led into the temple. And these are the six steps. Six is the number of man. And that means that God made this for you. And the first step that we take, see, one, is that a step? Now, I haven't walked until I take the second step. Two, hello. See, a walk is not just a step. You got to take step after step. Now you're walking by faith. And the word comes first. And when the word comes, then faith comes. See, when the preacher preaches, this is why God is called, chosen, equipped, qualified, sanctified, appointed, anointed, elected, selected, and ordained the preacher to preach, because the preacher is the mailman. He brings your mail. He brings your word. Now, I'm bringing you the word this morning. And when the word comes, then the Bible says in Romans chapter 10, he says, so then faith come. See, when the word comes, faith come, but faith doesn't stay. When the word comes, the second step is faith come. See, faith comes how? By hearing. And hearing what? By hearing the word. Some people, they ignore the word. That's the reason why they don't have faith when they leave the church. Because faith came, but they didn't get it, you see, because they didn't hear the word. Their minds is going somewhere else, as it were. They are looking at their, cell phone. They're texting while they're in church. That's so dishonorable with God. And God is saying, no, listen to the word. Because the word comes, then faith comes. Now, when faith comes, you got to get a hold of it. Romans chapter 10, chapter 10, he says, holding fast. Say, hold fast. James, he says, get a hold of that now. He says, hold fast to your confession of faith. See, the word comes, and when the word comes, then faith comes. How do I hold fast to that? Your confession of faith. Romans chapter 10, Hebrews chapter 10. He says in Hebrews chapter 10, hold fast. Say, hold fast. The confession of your faith. Now, when the word comes, God doesn't just want you to hear the word. Faith is released by saying Faith is released by you saying something. What should I say? Say what God says. Faith is released by you saying something, doing something, and giving something. See, when you say, you know, it's just like in the natural. If you go into the mall, very few people actually go to the mall, stumble and fumble, and they end up in the mall. They say, I'm going to the mall. And so they go to the mall. Wherever you're going, I'm going to work. They go to work. Wherever you're going, usually you say it where you're going. And so when we talk about confession, when the word comes, God is saying, say the word. Say the word. Say what you heard. Say faith. Can you say it? Say faith's progression into confidence. See, God wants you to have confidence in God. And you'll see what I'm saying in just a moment. But it starts with faith. And so when faith comes, because the word has come. Faith can't come without the word. Because faith come by hearing, and hearing by the word. So when the word comes and faith comes, you get a hold of that faith by confessing. The word confession, you already know it. What is it? Homo legeo. Homo means same, legeo means speak. Meaning you speak the same thing God says. God told his disciples, he said, we're going to the other side. And then he took them and got in the boat, and they were going to the other side. The sun was out. They was all sunshine. And then when the storm came up, did he know that storm was coming up? Yes, he did. He knew the storm was coming up because their faith had to be tested. You see, they thought they had faith in God. But when the storm came up, they went to God, the Son of God, Jesus Christ, and they said, don't you care? They accused him of not caring. Don't you care? We're going to die. And Jesus, in essence, said, where is your faith? You know it. He said, where is your faith? Because I said we're going to the other side. What did you say? You said we're going to die. You're not saying what I'm saying. Well, you know, the storm is beating up on the boat. Water's all in the boat. And Jesus said, listen, you're not saying what I'm saying. See, you are saying what you're seeing. But if you say what I'm saying, then you'll see what I'm saying. Oh, I'm getting excited. I get excited about this. I really do. Because this is how I live. I live by faith. Coming by the word of God. And then we got to confess it. We got to say it. See, some people, they don't say it. Some people, they don't do it. Whatever their condition is, the preacher comes out and tells everybody, lift up your hands and say amen. And folks just look at him like he's crazy. See, we already know. We already know where they are now, Lord. We already know where they are. They can't do just a simple thing. Somebody say, well, I can't lift my hands all the way up to the sky. Well, you can just hold up your hands. In other words, faith is released by doing something. You got to do something. You got to act on it. This is the reason why Jesus says, arise and be healed. Meaning if you arise, but I'm not healed. How can I arise and I'm not healed? Just in the attitude, if you arise. See, the word arise is a preparatory word. Say preparatory word. Is a preparatory word connected to a commandment. See, it's a preparatory word. When God told Joshua, arise and go over the Jordan. He didn't say go over the Jordan. They couldn't go over the Jordan if they did not arise. Arise is on the inside. And so the word comes, then faith comes. Hallelujah. And see, faith is the substance of what you hope for. If you lose your hope and the devil want to bring your hope down. Now, we're not going to go back and read what we read last week. But remember Romans chapter 4, it says that who against hope? Abraham, he was talking about Abraham. He said, who against hope? He believed in hope, even though hope was against him. Meaning he had no reason to hope, but he still did not let his hopes go down. Do you realize what hope? Hope means smile. When I was a little boy coming up, Nat King Cole sang that song. Smile, though your heart is breaking, smile. Yes, he did. He sang that. Though your heart is breaking. Go on in your internet and listen to it. It just blessed you. But then also, Valerie's girl, Now, I haven't seen the whole thing. I haven't never seen the whole thing. But just by Valerie singing, I mean, Valerie, she still sings Annie. Tomorrow, tomorrow. See, hope is tomorrow. Faith is today. Tomorrow is only a day away. Now, here's the thing. See, when you smile, it sends a message. Now, this is a scientific study shows that when a person smiles, this is not coming from me. This is a scientific study that shows when a person smiles, it sends a message to the brain to help you control the negative emotions and attitude. See, we live in a negative world. We live in a world where there's every reason to be sad, mad, gloomy, doomy. I mean, I can just go on, and time would fail to tell about all the things that we can be sad over, mad over, gloomy and doomy over. But the smile, he said, just smile. It sends a message to the brain to help control your negative emotions and attitude. To make you feel better. Just the smile. What? See, we take medicine, we still don't smile. Now, I'm not going to talk about you, but you should. I wish I had a mirror to show some of you how you're looking right now at me. No smile. And God is saying, just smile. You got every reason. He said, rejoice in hope. Rejoice. That word rejoice means smile. Though your heart is breaking. Somebody broke your heart, but you could smile. It sends a message to your brain, and it helps you what? Feel better. You know, I didn't feel real good this morning, praise the Lord, but I started smiling. Now, how would you like it for your preacher to come out here?
People, open your Bibles to my.
How would that sound? You say, what in the world is wrong with the preacher? Where is the joy? So he says, smile, because it makes you feel better. It sends a message to the brain. It makes you feel better. And it says, this is a scientific fact. It says it makes you feel better, and then it makes you live better. You live better when you smile. Now, I haven't met a person yet. Now, maybe there's some in here, and you can testify to me about that later. I haven't met a person yet who a man was attracted to the woman, or the woman. Now, the woman could be attracted to the man, because women look for bad men. You know, bad man. Michael Jackson say, I'm bad, I'm bad. You know, I'm bad. But men, they look for a woman to smile. To smile at them. And when they get married, I haven't married a couple yet. I'm telling you, I haven't met a couple yet that did not smile. You know, Joe Walker and his wife, Crystal, I never will forget their marriage. You know, usually I have to tell the man and the woman, okay, at some point in the ceremony, all right, now you may look at your bride-to-be. Look at your bride, because they're looking at me. They're listening to me. And look at your bride. But with Joe and Crystal, man, I thought they was high off of meth or something, man. I mean, they was just looking at each other. They were just not smiling. They were laughing at each other. I'm giving a ceremony, and they're laughing at each other, and they just smiling and laughing. And I said, man, what's going on here? That was one of the most joyful weddings that I'm telling you, man. It was just a blessing to me. I'm just looking at them both, and they just smiling and laughing. I don't know what they was laughing about, but they were just looking at each other. They wouldn't take their eyes. I had to, hey. Now say what I say. And he peeped at me, and he came back looking, smiling, said, that was a joyful. And what I'm saying is, you live better. When you smile, you live better. When you smile, you feel better. When you smile, you look better. You look better when you smile. And this is what he said. The word comes, faith comes, but now here comes the devil. This is what he says. Here comes the devil. He says in verse, look at this, in verse 3, not only so, but we glory in tribulations. That's try, T-R-I, like a tricycle, three times the trouble. The rain descends, the floods come, and the winds blow. That's three times the trouble. It's temptation, test, and trials. What did Satan do to our Lord and Savior now? He came to Jesus, and he tempted him with three temptations. And this is what he comes to us with. He said, tribulation, knowing that the tribulation worketh patience. Now, I was going to ask you to turn there, but let me just ask you to do this. Go to Mark chapter 4. Let's go there. Hold your place there. We want to come right back, but look at Mark chapter 4. Thank you, Jesus. This is our Lord and Savior teaching. And we're talking about Jesus, the promise keeper. He promises you he's going to get you through it. But the word come. You got to get the word. How do I get the word? Faith comes. How do you release your faith? By saying what he says. Faith is released by saying something, doing something, giving something. Mark chapter 4. Once you find your place, say hallelujah. Now here, you know, this just intrigues me and fascinates me. When the young people graduated from high school, that Saturday night, it was that Saturday night, I already had a different message prepared, and the Lord said, no, this is what I want you to preach tomorrow morning. I'm getting in bed. Lord, I can't. He said, you know, you don't have to take the notes on this. I'm going to give it to you. I want you to teach them this, and I have preached this many times. Have faith in God. And I mean, David, it was crystal clear. Hear God in the flesh telling his disciples. Now, you would think it's an automatic. If God, if you can touch God, you can eat with God, you sit with God. Well, and he says, have faith in God. The object of our faith is God. People have faith, but they can put it in other places, other people, other things. But he said, have faith in God. Then the objective of our faith is in verse 24. Verse 22, that's Mark chapter, don't turn there, just keep it in chapter 4. But Mark chapter 11, verse 22, he said, have faith in God. Verse 23, he says, for verily I say unto you, the objective of faith is you. The object is God. The objective is you. Can you say that? The object is God. What do we have our faith in? God. And the objective is you. Meaning Jesus says, for verily I say unto you, I'm talking to you. Look at your neighbor and say, he's talking to me. Isn't that crazy? People come to church and they say, he ain't talking to me. Then what you doing in the church? And God ain't talking to you. Something wrong with you if God won't talk to you. And Jesus said, for verily I say unto you. For verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say what I say unto the mountain, unto whatever your problem is, say what I say. So the objective is to know more about the God I put my faith in, grow more in the God I put my faith in, sow more in the God I put my faith in. And when we say sow, we're not talking just, Donnie, about sowing money. No, no. We're talking about sowing your time, your talents, your gifts, possession. In other words, how much do you know about the Bible? People today can run through that internet, Facebook, Twitter, all this stuff. They got it all together there. But when it comes to the Bible, you can say, turn to Daniel, and they got to go to the table of contents. You can tell them to turn to the book of Genesis. They're going, they're in the back of the book, Revelation. Well, where's Genesis? Where? That's the beginning of the Bible. So he's telling us the objective is I want you to grow in the God you know. Now, here's what he said. The word comes. Say the word comes. Then what comes? Number two, what's the second step? Faith comes. And number three, what's the third step? Here comes the devil. Here comes the devil. And this is what he says in chapter 4, verse 14. The sower soweth the word. Know more about the God you put your faith in. Grow more in the God you put your faith in. Sow more in the God you put your faith in. He said, the sower soweth the word. And these are they by the wayside, on the side of the highway of heaven. They're going to heaven, but they ain't going nowhere here. And these are they by the wayside where the word is sown. The word was sown. But when they have heard, now here it is, Satan come immediately. What did he come for? He didn't come for you. You're already damned if you don't believe. And I'm not cursing. That's what he says. He says that he that believe and shall be saved. But he that believe not is damned. He said they're already damned. They got every reason to be sad, every reason to be gloomy and doomy. But this is what he says, and I'm not cursing. That's in the Bible. Damnation. Condemnation. In other words, Satan brings the come. It says Satan come immediately and does what? What is he coming for? To take away the word that was sown in their hearts. He come to get that word. He don't want you to have that word. Because the word of God is, listen, more powerful than a two-edged sword. It'll cut the devil every way. When you speak the word of God, you're cutting him as under. The Bible says that the word of God is a sword that God has given unto you, a defense mechanism to cut the devil down. You'll cut him too short. You'll cut the devil down with the word of God. So what does he come? Immediately. When does he come? The word comes. Faith comes. Here comes the devil. Look at your neighbor and say, now he's coming already? Did you know the devil comes to church? Yes, he does. What does he come to church for? Not to give God a hallelujah. He come to church to steal the word from you. He come to church to put thoughts in your head while you're listening to the word of God that's preached. The devil comes and says, this ain't going to work for you. This is not going to help you. You've heard this before. Why you sit up here and listen to this? Keep listening to this and it ain't working, is it? The devil talks to your mind. Come on, smile. Yeah, because that sends a message to your brain. It does. Hallelujah. And the scientific fact, now this is, look it up. This is a scientific fact. They say, now the smile will even add years to your life. With the exception of some accident, incident, or something happening to you. But just smile can make you live a little longer. Just because you smile. Come on, everybody, smile. Go ahead, just practice. I'm telling you, you got to practice it. The smile doesn't automatically come upon your face. You got to practice smiling. You got to just practice. I got to practice it. Every time the bishop comes out, oh, he looks so happy. Well, he's not always happy. Listen, the same thing that you go through, I go through. Same situations, I go through. But we have to practice it. When you get up in the morning, do you wake up smiling? Oh. You don't wake up smiling. You wake up dragging, sagging. I got to, yeah, but you got to practice the smile. Practice the smile. Practice smiling. It'll add to your life, because Satan comes to steal, kill, and to destroy. Now go back to the book of Romans, and let's see this again. And he says in verse 3, and not only so, but we glory in tribulations. We glory in tribulations. Are you talking about puzzling the devil? The word come, faith come. Then what comes? Number 3. Here comes the devil. Here comes Satan. Here comes Satan. And Satan comes to depress you, oppress you, to vex you, to put you on the side of the highway. He says, but we glory in tribulations. Knowing, now here it is. See, God, only way you can know this if you go through this. You can't know what he's talking about unless you go through what he's talking about. Knowing that the tribulation worketh patience. See, so the fourth step is patience. So the word comes, faith comes, here comes the devil. Well, glory to God, hallelujah. Because now why? Tribulation worketh patience. Let patience go to work. I want you to hold your place there. Go to the book of before you go there, slip over to Romans chapter. Let's look at Romans chapter 15. Let me give you some scripture here. The word come, faith come. Here comes the devil to what? Steal the word. So now your faith doesn't have anything to give substance to. Your hope, confident, favorable expectation is gone. Hope is Elpis, E-L-P-I-S. You can look it up in W. Yvonne's New Testament words. But listen to this. Chapter 15, are you there? Chapter 15, verse 13. Now the God, listen to this. Now the God of hope fill you. He fills you, the God of hope. Don't let your hope go down. Now the God of hope, today, just practice smiling. When you go home and you got every reason to be frowning, go in the house smiling. And watch and see whoever's in your house will ask you, what you happy about? What you smiling for? Because God's going to fill you. He says, now the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, in believing, in believing, in believing, that you may abound in hope. Don't let your hope go down, but abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. Are you hearing me? Through the power of the Holy Ghost. See, hope will keep you from breaking under pressure. See, hope is important. It's a confident, favorable expectation. Only way you get to confidence is you got to go through in order for you to know you got to go. In order for you to know the experience of life in this world, you got to go through some things. And when you go through some things, you'll see that God is real. You'll see that what the pastor's been preaching to you, that God can make a way where there is no way. It's not my mama. It's not my papa. It's not, no, God is the one, and he's the only one, and God will get you through whatever valley you're going through. Hallelujah. And he'll fill you with joy while you're going through it. Glory to God. Hallelujah. 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 Somebody ought to praise the Lord and smile. Send a message to your brain. It's going to be all right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He'll fill you with hope. He'll fill you with hope. Now go to the book of Hebrews. Hallelujah. He'll fill you with hope. Well, I'm glad I'm a part of the Christian House of Prayer to hear this. Faith's progression into confidence. God wants you to have confidence. See, we go, listen to this. We go from faith, one step, to faith, and then into confidence. Meaning you come through the tests that the devil tests you, try you with. You come through the test, and now you know. The Bible says, listen, the Bible says, the Apostle Paul said it this way. The Apostle Paul says, I know in whom I have believed. See, you start off just believing, but then when you go through, you come to know in whom I have believed. I know him now. I know God will make a way now. I know God's going to do this thing now. No matter how it looks, I know God's going to get me through. No matter where you are, I know God's going to lift me up. I know this. I know this. I know this. Hallelujah. God can fix whatever's broken. I know he can. Why? He's done it before. Hallelujah. Not just with Abraham and with Sarah. They're the father of the faithful. But he did it with me. He did it with Valerie. He'll do it with you. Hallelujah. 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 So what, you may fuss a little bit and fight a little bit with your husband and with your wife. But confess, you know, there's some songs in the world, forgive me for putting these songs out on you, but there's some songs in the world that I love. Al Green, let's stay together. Let's stay together. And Al Green says, I just can't see. What did he say? He says, you know, I can't see. You make up after you break up. I just can't see. But then he said, let's stay together. I was flipping the station. I think I told you that last week. And who was it? Tina Turner. And I just happened to hit. I was flipping the station. And Tina Turner said, thank you, thank you. And then she went into that song, Let's Stay Together. And man, I started crying. I went into bed. See, on Sunday, I go in the bedroom. And Valerie go in the other room. And we don't meet up till around about 12 o'clock midnight. But when Tina started singing that song, man, I started crying. I went and got my wife. I'm telling you, Michelle, we start listening to it. All of a sudden, Valerie gets me around the waist, and we start dancing and saying, let's stay together. Loving you whether times are good or bad, or happy or sad. Let's stay together. Let's stay together. Let's stay together. Because what the devil is out to do is to tear us apart. You may say, I'm a single person. He's out to tear you apart. He's out to depart you. Listen to what he says in Hebrews chapter. Yes, sir. That's the rap man, man. Now you know. Hebrews chapter 5. Excuse me, chapter 6. Just smile. I'm missing. But Hebrews chapter 6. Hallelujah. Somebody say, let's stay together. Go ahead. As a congregation, let's stay together. Come on. Hallelujah. As a one person, let me stay together. Because the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. In Hebrews chapter 6. Are you there? Hebrews chapter 6. And then we're going to flip back over. The word comes. What comes next? Faith comes. What comes after faith? Here comes the devil. Say, here comes the devil. Here comes the devil. And then what goes next? Let patience go to work. Patience go to work. Now listen to this. He says in verse 12, and ye be not slothful, but followers of them. Followers of them. Who through faith and patience inherit the promise. Or the promises. For when Abraham made promise, when God made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, listen to this, he swore by himself. Now that's powerful, people. Here God sits on the throne, Dana, and God gets off the throne because he could swear by no greater. Nobody's greater than God. And God said, I swear to God, I'm going to do what I say. I swear to God. He could swear by no greater, so he swore by himself. God said, I swear to God, I'm going to get you through this. I swear to God. But you're God. I can't swear by no greater. There's none greater than me. So I'm going to swear to God, I'm going to get you out of this. I'm going to get you through this. And so Jesus is telling us the word comes, faith comes, here comes the devil, let patience go to work, and it'll bring you into experience. Experience. It'll bring you into experience. The word comes, faith comes, here comes the devil, let patience go to work. Do you know what patience is? Do I have a few more moments with you? See, the word patience, hupomene. In James chapter 1, verse 2, it says, count it all joy when you what? Fall into diverse temptations, tests, and trials. Knowing this, see, God wants you to know. It's only through confidence that you come to know. You start off just believing. And then God's going to take you through. And now you're going to have confidence because you're going to know. James says, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, tests, and trials. Knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. We just We just saw where faith and patience go together. See, patience, he says, and let patience, chapter 1, verse 2, and then verse 3, he says, let patience have her, feminine gender. See, patience is the her. Faith is the he or the him. Patience is the her. He said, let patience have her perfect work. See, a woman, hallelujah. Let me say it this way. When I was a little boy coming up, I always heard that saying, behind every good man is a good woman. It's a good woman, meaning she's got his back behind a good man. Now, we are joined together side by side. Women are not less than men. Women are not less than men. But God says to the women, submit. Sub, it means under. In other words, so you want me to go under? Yeah, he says submit because you're stronger. He says submit, meaning get under the mission. Now, you can be a general in the army and say charge and there's no soldiers under you. And ain't nobody going to obey you. What's the sense in being in charge if I can't say charge? So a good woman, hallelujah, like Michelle, you got a good woman, praise the Lord. And this is a good man. He said, yes, sir. I had deacon. Praise the Lord. And the thing is, a good woman, she'll back up a man. See, she don't have a problem. Fred, she don't have a problem getting behind her man and being in the corner of a man and supporting her man. Because sometimes we, see, as a man, sometimes, you know, the devil wants to crush us men. He wants to crush us men. But a good woman gets in the corner of a man and she tells the man, we're going to make it. She tells the man, we're going to stay together. She tells the man, you can do this thing. Go ahead. Not she gets in the corner and says to the man, what's wrong with you? Well, he said, let patience have her perfect work, feminine gender. And what patience does, it supports its faith. It tells faith, stay in there. See, the word patience is hupomene. Can you say that? Hupomene. Say it one more time. Hupomene. Can you say it again? Hupomene. Hupomene. When you leave this place, hupomene. 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 Hupomene means the force of consistency. It causes you to remain constant and always the same. Hupomene. It's the quality, if you would, that does not surrender to circumstances nor submit under trial. It's hupomene. It's the force of consistency. It causes us to remain constant and always the same. Stay in there. See, patience. So the word comes. Faith comes. Here comes the devil to steal the word so we won't have hope. Here comes the devil, but then it says, let patience go to work. Let patience go to work. Have you ever wondered why, for the most part, I thank God for all these men we got in this church. But for the most part, you go to a church and you may see one or two men, two or three, maybe five men at the most. And boy, that's good. All the women are in church. The women are in church. Because see, the women, boy, I tell you, they'll stand, they'll face that devil. One word is hupomene, the force of, you talking about the women are, man, that woman ain't strong on me, I'll give her a black eye. No, we ain't talking about physical strength. We're talking about she's supportive. Hupomene. Then there's another word, means long-suffering. Macrothumia. Now, I'm glad God made women strong. Because I don't want to have no baby. Talking about walking around. I don't want to have no baby. Boy, when you're having a baby, you're carrying, listen, a double load. You carrying the double O. You're talking about being stretched. You're talking about carrying. Macrothumia. It's long suffering. You know, how long do I have to suffer this, Lord? The doctor said, you know, 9 months. Sometimes it's shorter, whatever there. But 9 months. 9 months, that's almost a year. So if I'm going to have a baby, Oh, I'm so thank God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for making me a man. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Let me give honor to the women. The Bible says, give honor to the women like unto the weaker vessel. He didn't say because they're weaker. In other words, he's saying because they can submit. Ooh, I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful that women are strong, that they can carry another soul for 9. Oh, Lord, just the thought. Sometimes when I have a stomach ache, just sometimes I go crying to, just weeping and crying. Give me something. Joe, give me some orange juice. Give me some water. Man, to think about a woman got to carry that baby. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Give Jesus praise for the women. Thank him for the women, men. Let's thank God for the women. Let's praise him for the sisters. You may not have had a baby yet. Hallelujah. But God wants you to know you're still strong, woman. The word come, faith come, here comes the devil. Then let patience go to work that brings you into an experience. Experience. The word experience. Hallelujah. It means an expert or one that knows for sure. Write it down. See, the root derivative of experience is expert. It doesn't mean that we know everything. It just means that you have gone through something, that you know something now. You really know something now because you done gone through something now. You know something now. You're not on the side of the highway. Faith comes because the word comes. Here comes the devil. Let patience go to work. And it's going to bring you into experience. Experience. You have an experience. Hallelujah. Ooh, glory to God. God is so good, isn't he? You know, Deacon Joe, I got 4 sisters. But I tell you, if some of you try to mess with me, boy, them sisters, man, they can box, they know how to bob, weave. I mean, I didn't need no brother because my sisters can take care of my business, amen. Praise the Lord. They can take care of my business, amen. But here's my point. By me being the only boy, then you know everybody would call me a mama's boy. That's mama's boy, mama's boy. And when we talk about experience with women, see, in order for there to be a shift, you have to be the mama. That's my husband. Yeah, but in order for you to be what God wants you to be, still remember, I got to be the mama. Now, most women, not all, but not all, most women, they cook. When I was a boy, my mama cooked. My papa was a rolling stone, but my mama cooked. And so nowadays, when you marry somebody, for the most part, they're good cookers. Now we live today, boy, every time, we talk to a couple, and the man does the cooking, and the woman said, now, I can cook, but boy, he cooks better than me. Man, it's like I want to go underneath the table because Valerie looks at me as if to say, you know, I used to cook. Dr. Donald, I could cook. Nobody can outcook me on French fries. I could cook some French fries, Hal. Not eggs and French fries, just French fries. And I would stand over the French fries and I would never move. I would just watch them flip them. And Valerie said, honey, they're gonna cook by themselves. No, I'm cooking French fries and I'm flipping. So whenever men say, man, I'm the cook around the house, my wife looks at me and, you know, I go underneath the table. But I'm saying when we let experience work, it brings us into the end. The word come, faith come, here comes the devil. Let patience go to work. It'll bring you into an experience, and you will never lose your hope. Hope, hallelujah. You'll never lose your hope. Yeah, give him a praise. You'll never lose your hope. And the word hope is a confident, favorable expectation. See, your expectation is based upon your relevant application. I need you to write this down. For me, give me some notes after this one. Your expectation is based upon your relevant application of obedience. Meaning, when you obey, the word comes. Faith comes. When you obey, then you have an expectation. But it's based upon the relevant application of your obedience to God's correction and instructions. And if God can't correct me, I'm telling you, brother, he won't instruct me. If God can't correct me, he won't instruct me. That's the first thing that God does through the word of God. He corrects us, and then he instructs us. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for what? Correction and instruction. All scripture is given by the inspiration of God, and it will become profitable for correction and instructions. And if God can't correct us, that's why some people say, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. Let God correct you. Let God be the one to tell you you're going the wrong way. Let God be the one to tell you, I got a better way for you. I got something so much better for you. And when you follow that, then there's a hope that will not die. Let me close with this. You know, when I was a young boy coming up, we was on our bikes coming from Huntington Park. And there was a gang of us, man, riding. I had Brother Larry Stokes. He's one of them. Larry Stokes was a member of our church. He's still in Texas, but he's in another city. And Larry was on my bike, and I think about this oftentimes. I really do, because I think about it in the sense that, man, he could have died, and boy, that would have just done something to me. But we were the youngest ones. I like to hang out with the old heads, and we were the youngest ones, and they was riding their bikes. And I had Larry on my bike, and Larry was telling me, he said, stop it, because they had already crossed the big street. He said, stop it, but I wanted to be a big man, so I wasn't going to stop. And I went across that street, and we looked to the right, and here comes the car. And that car hit us and knocked us all the way on the other side. And it knocked me completely out. I think about this, and I think about my mother. How does she feel when she heard? We was about three blocks away from home, and I was out. And my mother, and everybody was standing around. Larry was standing there. He was hopping. He had got hit too, but he didn't get knocked out. I was out, probably dead, honestly, probably dead. And when I opened up my eyes, my mother was standing there, everybody around, and my mother was shouting, get up! And see, this is what the Lord was giving her. She wouldn't touch me. She was just saying, get up, Butch, get up, Butch. And I opened up my eyes, and there was my mother shouting, get up. And I went to get up, and my leg went limp. And my friends went to grab me. My mother said, no, his leg's broke. I said, my leg is broke. The ambulance came. They took me to the hospital. I was in there, mama crying. She was so thankful to God that I'm still alive. And the doctor came in and he says, now, Nathaniel, I want to ask you some questions. And the question he asked me, he says, how did you break your leg? And I remember this moment because I'm thinking, boy, now, wait a minute. If the doctor don't know how I broke my leg, I said, man, you know, he's probably going to really jump on me because I wasn't obedient in terms of that bite. But he says, no, I need you to tell me, Nathaniel. I'm looking at my mother. I'm expecting her to tell you. He said, no, I need you to tell me. How did you break your leg? I said, well, I was riding on my bike and I get hit by a car. He said, that's good, Nathaniel. And at that moment, he began to share with me because, see, if you didn't know how you broke your leg, now we got two problems. You won't need just a physical doctor, but you're going to need a psychiatrist. So he said, that's good, Nathaniel. He said, now this is, I never forgot this, Pam. He said, now, Nathaniel, what I'm going to do, I'm going to restructure your leg and put your leg back in place. He said, but I'm going to have to put a cast on it. Because the moment that you move, it's going to fall back out of place. So I got to put a cast on it. He said, after I put a cast on it, I'm going to give you crutches, Nathan. I said, crutches? He said, yeah, I want you to stay off that leg. Don't walk on the leg. He said, now, the leg's going to heal, and you're going to feel that you can walk on the leg, and you will be able to walk on it. You'll be able to walk on that leg. He said, but Nathaniel, if you stay off the leg and stay on the crutches until you come back, he says, Nathaniel, this is a promise. I'm going to cut the cast off. He says, and this is a promise. You will walk again. You will run again. I never forgot it, Vicky. He said, tell your friends, get the bike ready. You'll ride again. He put the cast on. I went home filled with pain. My friends came by. How you doing, man? And I'm filled with pain. I says, you know, I said, I'm doing much better. The doctor said, they asking me, how do you feel? I said, the doctor said. They asking me, how do you feel? Instead of me saying, oh, man, I'm feeling pain. I'm hurt. I said, the doctor said that as long as I stay off my leg and stay on the crutches, the doctor said that when he cut the cast off, the doctor said, I'm a walk again. The doctor said, I'll run again. The doctor said, Nathaniel, this is a promise. Tell your friends to get the bike ready. You'll ride again. It's a promise. This is what God is saying to us. God is saying, you're going to walk again. You're going to be able to run again. You're going to be able to do it again. If you just obey what I said, keep your hope up. No matter how you feel now, no matter how you look now, what did the doctor say? Jesus is our doctor, and Jesus wants you to know that the end is better than the beginning. You're going to do it again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. A good man may fail 7 times, but he'll get back up again. Why? Because God is the one that's going to lift you up. God is the one that's going to pick you up. God is the one that's going to help you. Hallelujah. He will help you up. Somebody give him praise. Hallelujah. 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 Smile. Though your heart is aching, smile. Though your heart is breaking, smile. You can smile. Because it'll send a message to your brain that everything is going to be all right. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Give him praise. Woo! Come on, praise him. It's going to be all right. Come on, give God praise. Praise him because you're going to win. Praise him because God already got it in the script. You're going to win no matter what you're going through. He's able. He's able. He's able to get you through. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.